Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Outsmarting Alzheimer's, What You Can Do to Reduce Your Risk, by Kenneth S. Kosik, M.D. Narrated by Barry Abrams. Publisher's note, this audiobook is packaged with bonus material, which has been included on the first audio and MP3 CD. If you downloaded this audiobook in a digital format, please visit Tantor.com and type Outsmarting Alzheimer's, What You Can Do to Reduce Your Risk, into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then click on PDF Extra 1. When prompted, enter the access code BRAIN to access the bonus material. Introduction. If you've selected a book like this one 20 years ago, you'd find little hope between its covers. Back then, many scientists believed that dementia, a noticeable loss of mental functioning caused by Alzheimer's or any number of other brain diseases, was a natural and inevitable consequence of aging. In your 40s or 50s, so it was thought, you'd start to experience mild senior moments, such as occasionally losing your reading glasses or car keys. Into your 60s and 70s, you'd increasingly find that you'd walked into a room but had forgotten why. Maybe, during conversations, you'd lose your train of thought. New tasks, such as learning how to program the television, would make your head hurt. If you were fortunate enough to live into your 80s and 90s, your mind would continue to unravel. Your family members would seem like strangers. Eventually, you'd no longer remember basic self-care and personal hygiene. Ultimately, you'd die from infections like pneumonia or bed sores. The only thing that would stop you from eventually dying of complications from dementia? Dying of heart disease, cancer, or some other disease first. Well, I'm happy to report that all of this has dramatically changed for the better. More than 73,000 research papers about causes and treatments for dementia have been published in the past 20 years. That's an average of 10 papers a day. In recent years, thanks to the development of functional magnetic resonance imaging, fMRI for short, we've been able to peer inside of the human brain while people are still alive, studying brain activity in real time. This new tool has led to several exciting scientific developments that have changed our understanding of the aging brain and also of Alzheimer's disease, the most common cause of dementia. We now know that our brains are remarkably resilient. They're not stuck in time. Rather, they're capable of maintaining and repairing themselves, a phenomenon we refer to as plasticity. This is why some stroke victims eventually recover and regain the ability to talk and move. Their brains build new connections, relearning how to form words and how to move affected muscles. This is particularly true if we provide our brains with what they need to complete these important maintenance tasks. Just as a state-of-the-art highway system needs maintenance workers, new asphalt, and the occasional new construction crew to change continually for the better, our brains need a rich environment with social, cognitive, and physical stimulation. Outsmarting Alzheimer's will show you how to create the optimum environment for continual brain maintenance. The Brain Smarts prescriptions in Part 2 will teach you what you need to do to remodel your brain for the better. Old brains can grow new cells. The size of your brain is, in part, determined by the number of brain cells, also called neurons, it contains. If new brain cells are created at the same pace that older cells die off, your brain volume remains constant. If cells die off faster than cells are created, the brain shrinks, and cognitive health declines. What does it take to stop the brain from shrinking as we age? Exercise, a healthy diet, a rich social life, good sleep habits, and a combination of other brain smarts suggested in Outsmarting Alzheimer's. These strategies can protect your brain even if you were genetically predisposed to developing Alzheimer's disease. When researchers from the Cleveland Clinic in Ohio used fMRI machines to scan the brains of 100 men and women who had a family history of Alzheimer's disease, they found that the hippocampal brain regions of people who exercised remained the same size over an 18-month period, a time period that would normally be associated with a small amount of brain shrinkage. Other research finds that a healthy lifestyle, similar to what we suggest in Outsmarting Alzheimer's, can even increase the volume of the hippocampus by 1-2% over 1 year. This is important because the hippocampus is the region of the brain most affected by Alzheimer's disease. When we change our lifestyles for the better, our brains change for the better too. I've spent the past 25 years researching Alzheimer's disease, first at Harvard Medical School and later at University of California, Santa Barbara. As a neurologist, I've treated patients who either have already been diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease or who are at risk for developing it. During this time, I've watched as fascinating research trends have unfolded. On the one hand, studies have dashed our hopes over and over again when it comes to finding a prescription medicine or technological treatment for Alzheimer's disease. On the other hand, a vast and growing body of research shows that lifestyle habits, what you eat, whether you exercise, how you sleep, the quality of your social connections, what you do to buffer stress, whether you challenge your mind, can dramatically reduce your risk for developing this disease. Risk is a statistical term that describes your chances of getting a disease. We all have some risk for developing Alzheimer's disease, but some of us, because of our genes, a history of concussions, and high blood pressure, among many other factors, are at a greater risk than others. Just as people who live in Seattle are at a greater risk of experiencing a rainy day than people who live in San Diego. No matter your current level of risk, however, you can reduce the chances of suffering the symptoms of Alzheimer's disease, just as people who live in Seattle reduce their risk of getting wet by carrying umbrellas wherever they go. Scientists and researchers have never been more optimistic about our ability to help you tackle this disease. A recent statistical review concluded that modifiable risk factors, things like diabetes, inactivity, smoking, high blood pressure, depression, lack of education, and so on, contributed to a third or more cases of Alzheimer's disease. Other research estimates that lifestyle changes may prevent as many as half of all Alzheimer's cases. Yes, healthy living has always been a good idea. This in itself is not news. Depending on how closely you follow breaking health news, the strategies that will help you reduce your risk for Alzheimer's disease may or may not seem familiar. You've heard that you should exercise and eat more vegetables, for example, to reduce your risk for heart disease, diabetes, cancer, and many other diseases. But until recently, the incredible impact of healthy living on the brain wasn't clear. Alzheimer's disease, perhaps the most frightening disease we know, does not have to loom in your later years as some inevitable fate. It's not an inevitable consequence of aging, a condition for which we have no cure, but a disease that every single one of us can combat with clear and effective steps. Many years of scientific evidence have revealed the risk factors for Alzheimer's disease, as well as the strategies to reduce many of those risks. So why not embrace these strategies? Just as you save for retirement, why not put good health bucks in your cognitive account? Why not rack up some cognitive savings by adopting the brain-healthy habits so you are less likely to incur the problems that are shockingly common among seniors? Why not provide yourself with the best chance for enjoying the happiest time of your life? Yes, the happiest time. Among all age groups, seniors are the happiest, with one exception, those in poor health. The suggestions here don't require testing and treatment from a tertiary care center. In fact, much of what is in this book does not require a doctor at all. That's because, in Outsmarting Alzheimer's, we are focusing on health, whereas, unfortunately, the medical system is preoccupied with disease. Few doctors will take the time to fully explain the lifestyle habits that affect your health and keep your brain in top shape. In contrast, we have packed this book with 80 suggestions that will help you live out your senior years with happiness, good health, and a sharp mind. Not long ago, a team of Finnish and Swedish researchers revealed the encouraging results of a large study that followed more than 1,000 people aged 66 to 77 who were considered to be at high risk for developing Alzheimer's disease. It was called the Finnish Geriatric Intervention Study to Prevent Cognitive Impairment and Disability, FINGER, and the initial results were just published in the spring of 2015. After several years, study participants who overhauled their lifestyles to include nutritious eating, regular exercise, and intellectual pursuits performed at least 25% better on tests of memory, thinking, and problem-solving than did other study participants who didn't take steps to improve their lifestyles. On tests of executive function, the ability to organize and regulate thought processes, they scored 83% higher, and their processing speed, how quickly they responded to new information, was 150% higher. All told, this was enough to delay a dementia diagnosis by 2 years and reduce the prevalence by 25%. Had the interventions been started earlier in life, there's good reason to suspect that the results would have been even more dramatic. A separate study by a team at Rush University Medical Center in Chicago found that people who consumed a diet rich in leafy greens, veggies, nuts, berries, beans, and other wholesome foods slashed their risk for Alzheimer's disease by up to 53% over nearly 5 years. Finally, based on results from nearly 2,000 people enrolled in the Mayo Clinic study of aging, we also know that intellectual hobbies, like the one suggested in Chapter 7, may delay Alzheimer's symptoms by up to 10 years. In other words, if based on your genes and past lifestyle, you would normally have developed problems with memory and thinking around age 85, intellectual pursuits may postpone those symptoms until around age 95. It was research results like the ones I just described that prompted me to start the Center for Cognitive Fitness and Innovative Therapies, CFIT, in Santa Barbara in 2009. CFIT was one of the first programs in the country dedicated to helping people reduce their risk for Alzheimer's disease. I wanted to help people adopt lifestyle habits that would help them avoid getting this disease altogether, or, at the very least, put off its symptoms for as long as possible. When people came to CFIT, they were cared for by a comprehensive team of professionals that included nutritionists, exercise physiologists, stress reduction experts, physical therapists, and cognitive psychologists. Rather than a medical center, it was more like a gym for the brain. The recommendations in this book are based on the practical lessons I learned from CFIT as well as the extensive medical literature. The prescriptions you'll find within Outsmarting Alzheimer's represent the best thinking on how to reduce your risk of developing this terrible disease. Now is the time to outsmart Alzheimer's. It really is possible to live into your 60s, 70s, 80s, and beyond with sharp wits and excellent powers of recall. You can outsmart Alzheimer's disease and enjoy old age with a healthy, vibrant mind. Outsmarting Alzheimer's will show you the way. Throughout Outsmarting Alzheimer's, you'll find scientifically sound strategies that have been shown to reduce your risk for poor brain health and cognitive deterioration, such as memory loss. When incorporated into your life, these strategies can help to reduce your risk of developing Alzheimer's disease. In the past few years, there's been a shift in the thinking for many of us who study dementia. We've come to the conclusion that the best time to treat Alzheimer's disease is before the earliest symptoms surface. This shift has been brought on by new technology that allows us to peer inside the human brain. In 2012, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration approved the use of a substance, called a tracer, that could be injected into the bloodstream and allow specific substances in the brain to light up during a positron emission tomography, PET scan. Thanks to this and other techniques, we now know that the Alzheimer's plaques begin to proliferate 10 or even 20 years before the first Alzheimer's symptoms become noticeable. This is not unlike other disease processes. Take heart disease. Long before the first hint of chest pain, fatty deposits are silently coating artery walls. By the time you first feel chest pain or suffer from shortness of breath, you're well on your way to having your first heart attack. It's the same with cancer. Tumors silently grow long before the first ache, bout of fatigue, or dizziness. In all of these diseases, it's during this silent phase that treatment is most effective. Yet, most people are diagnosed with Alzheimer's only after serious symptoms have already set in. By this time, many brain cells have died or become irreparably damaged because they have filled up with rope-like structure called tangles that strangle the cells. At the same time, the space between the cells fills up with a hardened, sticky protein called plaque. Together, the plaques and tangles make up the classic hallmarks of Alzheimer's disease. Treating Alzheimer's at this stage is a lot like treating cancer after it has already spread throughout the body, or like treating heart disease after the first heart attack has already taken place. It's much more effective to treat these diseases during their earliest stages, and even more effective to prevent them from developing in the first place. Though we don't currently have a widely available diagnostic test that can definitively predict whether the Alzheimer's disease process is already silently spreading through your brain, there are a few clues that can give you a sense of your current level of risk, and you'll learn more about them in Chapter 2. No matter how many or how few risk factors you may have, however, now is the best time to incorporate the strategies from Outsmarting Alzheimer's into your life. Slow the progression of Alzheimer's disease. Maybe you're listening to this book because you're already experiencing frustrating episodes of forgetting. If so, you may be wondering, is it too late? New research from Sweden's Karolinska Institutet's finger trial mentioned earlier tells us that it's not. I mentioned this research just a little bit ago. After following the health outcomes of more than 1,200 people over 2 years, the researchers found that even people already experiencing early symptoms of dementia benefited from a comprehensive program that included brain-smart eating, exercise, intellectual pursuits, and medical care. They performed better on tests of memory, planning, judgment, and problem-solving than did other study participants who didn't participate in the same program. This was true of all of the study participants who took part in the program, even those in their late 70s. So I hope it's comforting to know that it may never be too late to take steps to improve your brain's health. No matter your age and no matter how many symptoms you have, a healthy lifestyle can help. In Outsmarting Alzheimer's, you'll find dozens of simple strategies to slow the progression of the disease as much as possible, delaying the full onset of the disease by as many as 10 years. Improve your well-being. Outsmarting Alzheimer's is for everyone affected by Alzheimer's disease. Whether you're trying to prevent Alzheimer's disease, already have it, or are caring for someone who does, you'll find advice to help you to reduce stress, live life to the fullest, and find peace of mind. The myths of Alzheimer's disease. Why aren't more people taking steps to reduce their risk of Alzheimer's disease? The answer to that question is complex, but at least some of it stems from pervasive societal myths about who is at risk for this disease. Understanding these myths can help you to put them in their place, as well as find the motivation you need to get off the couch, stock the fridge with produce, and sign up for that yoga class. Let's take a look at some of the more common myths that may stand between you and your ability to outsmart Alzheimer's. Myth number one: if I live long enough, I will get Alzheimer's disease. Many people assume that forgetting and a lack of mental clarity are normal consequences of aging. They're not. And the best way to show this is with a story about a remarkable autopsy. Within hours after 115-year-old Hendrik van Andel Schipper died of cancer, scientists transported the Dutch woman's body to the University of Groningen in the Netherlands. As expected, during autopsy, they found tumors in Andel Schipper's stomach, liver, kidneys, and armpit. It's what they didn't find that stunned them. In her brain, they'd expected to see tangles of dead or damaged cells and clusters of plaque, both signs of Alzheimer's disease. To their amazement, however, they found no hardened plaque and very few tangles. Her blood vessels were equally free of disease. And when the scientists tediously counted the number of a specific type of brain cell in one part of Andel Schipper's brain, and then counted again just to be sure, the tally reached higher than 16,000, roughly the number of cells they would have expected to find in a healthy 60-year-old in the equivalent region of the brain. They concluded, in contrast to general belief, the age limits of human cognitive function may extend far beyond the range that is currently enjoyed by most individuals. She's no anomaly. Though scientists didn't have the opportunity to dissect their brains, we can infer from their life accomplishments that many others lived into old age with vibrant cognitive health. The artist Pablo Picasso produced a torrent of etchings and paintings in the years just before his death at age 92. Actor George Burns won an Academy Award at the age of 79, starred in a film just 2 years before his death at age 100, and remained witty. When asked his secret of achieving old age, he famously said, "If you live past 100, you've got it made. Very few people die past that age." Jimmy Carter, Henry Kissinger, Betty White, and many others have remained sharp-witted well into their 90s. And then there's Jean Calment, who lived to age 122. French neuropsychologist and epidemiologist Karen Ritchie examined Calment 4 years before her death. Ritchie found that the then 118-year-old Calment was incredibly sharp-witted. After meeting with Calment several different times over a period of many months, Ritchie concluded that Calment had, quote, no evidence of senile dementia. Can I promise that outsmarting Alzheimer's will help you stay sharp and vibrant until your 100th birthday and beyond? No, but I can promise you this. The solutions and personalized approach in this book will definitely give you your best shot at doing so. Myth number 2. If Alzheimer's disease runs in my family, I'll eventually get it no matter what I do. The genes that we inherit from our parents do influence whether we will eventually develop Alzheimer's disease, among others. But we've learned that they don't predict our future with absolute certainty. Whether we carry an Alzheimer's gene or not, our risk for developing the disease doubles every 5 years after age 65, and it reaches nearly 50% after age 85. In other words, we all have close to a 50% chance of developing Alzheimer's disease after age 85. For someone who has one copy of the APOE4 gene, however, risk reaches 50% a decade earlier, by age 75. Someone with two copies of this gene, inheriting one from each parent, has a 50% chance of developing Alzheimer's disease by age 65. Those statistics, however, are not quite as dire as they may seem. First, while APOE4 raises risk, other genes may also be present that lower risk. Second, as research is showing, with brain smarts, you can outsmart the APOE4 gene and diminish the likelihood of future cognitive impairment. For example, in one study, fit study participants who were carriers of the APOE4 gene had brain scans comparable to those of people at low risk for developing Alzheimer's disease, whereas sedentary study participants who were carriers of the same gene experienced a 3% shrinkage in this area of the brain over the same period of months. In another study, participants who were carriers of the APOE4 gene were able to postpone the development of Alzheimer's disease by almost a decade if they spent their adult lives immersed in intellectually enriching activities. It's important to understand, however, that you can't outsmart all Alzheimer's genes. Several years ago, neurologist Francisco Lopera told me of 12 interrelated families in Antioquia, Colombia, whose members were experiencing Alzheimer's symptoms often around age 45. For most people, dementia symptoms don't set in until after age 65 or later. Intrigued, I agreed to help Lopera discover the gene mutation that might be at work. We soon learned that the extended family members with early onset dementia numbered in the thousands, and they were passing on a segment of DNA from one generation to the next that contained a defective gene called presenilin-1, PSEN-1. If one parent has this particular gene mutation, there's a 50% chance that each of his or her children will have it too. Those who inherit the mutant gene will develop early onset Alzheimer's, and at the moment, there's nothing they can do to stop it. I tell you the story of this large Colombian family because sometimes people confuse the APOE4 with this or other PSEN1 gene mutations that they may have heard or read about in news reports, mistakenly thinking that, based on their family history, an Alzheimer's diagnosis is inevitable, when in reality, it's not. If you have a strong family history of Alzheimer's disease, you can quickly get a sense of which gene your family members are likely passing down by considering two questions. 1. Have any of your family members developed Alzheimer's before age 60? 2. Did you develop Alzheimer's symptoms before age 60? If you answered no to both questions, then you probably do not have one of the rare, very serious mutations, such as the one in the presenilin gene. Yes, you may have one or two copies of APOE4, but these are the genes you can challenge and possibly outsmart. If you answered yes to either or both questions, remember that these gene mutations are exceedingly rare, so you may not have any detectable mutation. However, you may wish to undergo genetic testing. Genetic testing is expensive, and it is not usually reimbursed by insurance. It's also a serious undertaking, which not only affects you, but also your children and your grandchildren. But it may help you plan for the future. Myth number 3. I don't need to worry about Alzheimer's disease because no one in my family has it. It may surprise you to know that you can develop Alzheimer's disease even if you can't think of one family member with this disease. We're all at risk for Alzheimer's. Remember the statistics I mentioned earlier? We all have a 50% chance of developing Alzheimer's disease after age 85. Most people diagnosed with late-onset Alzheimer's disease do not test positive as carriers for any of the known Alzheimer's genes. In addition to genetics, many other factors play a role in determining your risk for developing Alzheimer's. You may be at higher risk for Alzheimer's because of a past history of concussions, because of high blood pressure or another health problem, or because of your lifestyle. No matter whether you can trace Alzheimer's disease through several generations of your family or not, it's still important to take steps to outsmart this disease. This disease is very common as we age, so everyone is at risk. How you'll outsmart Alzheimer's disease. In the United States, about 5.3 million people have Alzheimer's disease. To put that in perspective, that's the same number of every single man, woman, and child currently living in Scotland. Worldwide, the numbers are even more staggering, reaching 36 million people. And those numbers are growing. By 2030, it's estimated that 66 million people will have Alzheimer's disease. By 2050, 115 million. Alzheimer's disease is one of the biggest worries that we have as we age, and yet it's hard to find viable medical solutions. To date, there is no surgery, procedure, or medicine that can cure Alzheimer's disease. The available Alzheimer's medications do not modify the disease course. They simply provide modest amelioration of symptoms for a short time, and they don't work for everyone. Now for the good news. You may not need prescription Alzheimer's medication to outsmart this terrible disease. Within this book, you'll find everything necessary to create your best chances of beating it. The Brain Smart prescriptions in Part 2 can all be found outside of a pharmacy. More important, they're fun, pleasurable, and easy to adopt. And they may surprise you. Did you know that within the produce section of your grocery store are countless ways to reduce your risk for Alzheimer's? Or that you're lowering your risk of Alzheimer's every time you plan a dinner party and puzzle over what to cook, who should sit next to whom, and how to ensure all your dishes are ready around the same time the guests arrive? Planning, which we call executive function, is an excellent brain exercise. How fun would it be to know when you step out onto the dance floor, you're taking a step away from Alzheimer's? How relaxing and soothing would it be to know that you're protecting your brain whenever you unroll your yoga mat, take a morning walk, or relax with a short, early afternoon power nap? Did you know that a morning cup of coffee may prevent this disease, but a late afternoon cup of joe might increase your risk? Or that one glass of wine with dinner offers delicious protection, but more glasses after dinner do not? How motivating would it be to know that all of those hobbies and interests that you've been putting off, acting lessons, world travel, singing, even bingo, work to reduce your risk of getting Alzheimer's disease? It's all true. These are just a few examples of the dozens of prescriptions you'll find throughout the pages of this book. They all add up to a well-rounded, comprehensive, and personalized plan that will help you to powerfully improve the health of your blood vessels, your heart, your cells, and yes, your brain, for the better. In Outsmarting Alzheimer's, I'll share with you the 6 keys that have the most scientific evidence for protecting the health of your brain. These keys form the Brain Smart Plan. S equals social smarts. Slash your risk of cognitive decline by leaning on the support of your friends and family. M equals meal smarts. Key diets from around the world have been shown to reduce disease, improve longevity, and protect the health of the brain. Rich in plant foods and low in highly processed foods, these eating patterns preserve brain function and overall health. Here's more. Brain smart eating includes many of the foods and beverages you already have come to know and love: fruit, coffee, wine, and much more. A equals aerobic smarts. The more you move, the fewer brain cells you lose. Exercise may even boost the production of new brain cells. Best of all, brain smarts are easier to fit into your schedule than you may think. You can take powerful steps to boost your physical fitness in just 7 minutes a day. Learn more in Chapter 5. R equals resilience smarts. Long-term, unremitting stress is bad for your entire body, including your brain. So are depression, anxiety, and other chronic emotional problems, raising your risk of Alzheimer's by as much as 135%. On the other hand, meditation, deep breathing, massage, and other relaxing activities help to keep the brain resilient, so it more easily weathers daily stressors. Also, not all stress is bad for the brain. Some of it actually keeps your brain sharp. Learn the difference in Chapter 6. T equals train your brain smarts. The more you challenge your brain by learning new languages, playing musical instruments, contemplating brain teasers, and more, the better your brain's ability to fend off Alzheimer's. Based on results from nearly 2,000 people enrolled in the Mayo Clinic study of aging, we know that a college education, a mentally demanding profession, and intellectually engaging hobbies all have the ability to delay declines in brain functioning. Study participants who were carriers of one of the Alzheimer's genes were able to postpone the development of Alzheimer's disease by almost a decade if they spent their adult lives immersed in intellectually enriching activities. Study participants without the gene postponed the development of the disease even longer. S equals sleep smarts. men who reported poor sleep habits had a higher risk of developing Alzheimer's disease within the next 40 years compared to men who reported normal sleep. But this doesn't necessarily mean you must force yourself to sleep 7 to 9 hours every night, nor do we know yet whether improved sleep habits will reduce risk. Nevertheless, find out the best amount of sleep for your body, as well as several effective strategies to ensure the sleep you do get is more restorative, in Chapter 8. In addition to the Brain Smart prescriptions in Part 2, be sure to know your numbers. By numbers, I'm talking about the test results for health conditions that can affect your cognitive health. Those include your blood pressure, cholesterol, and blood sugar levels. When these numbers fall outside the normal range, safe medications, treatments, and lifestyle changes are available to correct them, including some of the lifestyle suggestions in this book. It's also important to keep the pounds off. Excess weight raises your likelihood for developing diabetes, high blood pressure, and elevated blood cholesterol, all of which raise your risk for Alzheimer's. People who are overweight are more likely to be diagnosed with dementia than people who remain slender. You'll learn more about the interplay between all of these medical conditions and Alzheimer's in Chapter 2. The best approach to preventing and delaying Alzheimer's is a personalized one. The 3-week plan in Chapter 9 will help you to choose and organize the right strategies for you into a successful program that you can adopt and maintain for years to come. And most important, you'll also find out how to make change possible. It's one thing to know what to eat or how much to exercise. It's quite another to do it. By personalizing an array of choices, you really can embrace your new healthy lifestyle. Within this book, you'll also find helpful advice on how to stay motivated, as well as how to turn unfamiliar healthy behaviors into habits. A comprehensive approach. Throughout Outsmarting Alzheimer's, you'll find sound medical advice that will help you guide your decisions about what to eat, how much to sleep, when and how to exercise, and much more. You'll also discover what you don't need to worry about. Do you need to buy and take an arsenal of supplements? To forego every trace of aluminum foil? To stop using antiperspirant? Probably not, and you'll find out why. The onslaught of temptations waged against the brain is multi-pronged. Menus with seductively photographed high-calorie desserts, full email inboxes, and computer work that keep you sitting in your office chair for hours. Mindless TV reruns that are on air at any time of the day or night. The constant feeling of being on call as your phone pings, dings, and buzzes late into the night. Because the attacks on our brains are pervasive, the solution must be comprehensive too. Nowhere in these pages will you find a single magic bullet. There is no expensive wonder food, no rare tea found only in the high mountains of a faraway place, no single yoga position or breathing style or crossword puzzle, and certainly no miracle supplement that is the secret to lifelong cognitive health. It would be naive to think that one remedy can undo years of a sedentary lifestyle, fast food consumption, loneliness, stress, and boredom. Instead, use this book to devise an entire package of risk-reducing measures. Pick what fits your lifestyle and health needs, but cover all bases. New research from the finger trial I mentioned earlier shows that this type of personalized, comprehensive approach offers the most promise for maintaining lifelong cognitive health. This 2-year intervention did not study just one drug, one eating approach, one exercise plan, one way to connect with others, or one type of brain training system. Rather, participants in the study learned and practiced a personalized combination of all of these strategies. Mia Kivipelto, MD, PhD, a professor at the Karolinska Institutet Center for Alzheimer's Research in Sweden, and her team followed the health outcomes of more than 1,200 people over 2 years, and they found that every measure of cognitive performance, including measures of memory, planning, and problem solving, improved. During the July 2014 Alzheimer's Association International Conference in Copenhagen, Denmark, Kivipelto presented the latest findings, commenting, quote, "It's never too late to do something. It is possible. By flexing your brain smarts, you really can outsmart Alzheimer's disease. It's never too early, and it's never too late. No matter your family history, age, or symptoms, now is the time to take steps to outsmart this terrible disease." Part 1. Why Everyone Needs to Outsmart Alzheimer's. Every person on this planet is at risk for developing Alzheimer's disease. This is true regardless of our age, family history, or current state of health. That's the bad news. The good news is that nearly all of us are equally capable of dramatically reducing our risk and living well into our old age with vibrant health and sharp minds. In this part of the book, you'll learn what Alzheimer's is, how it affects our brains, and why right now is the best time to do something about it. It's never too early, and it's never too late to elevate your well-being and decrease your chances of devolving into dementia. You'll also take a quiz designed to give you an idea of your personal Alzheimer's risk score and how you might improve it. Chapter 1. Your Brain on Alzheimer's. When physician Alois Alzheimer came to examine her, Auguste Dieter was sitting on the hospital bed, a helpless expression on her face. Alzheimer asked, "What's your name?" "Auguste," answered the 51-year-old patient at Frankfurt Hospital. "Last name?" "Auguste," she repeated. "What's your husband's name?" "Auguste," she said, sounding confused. "I think." "Your husband?" "Ah, my husband." "Are you married?" "To Auguste." Later, while she was eating cauliflower and pork for lunch, Alzheimer asked, "What are you eating?" "Spinach," Dieter answered. "What are you doing?" he asked. "Potatoes." Throughout the examination, Alzheimer took meticulous notes, jotting down the conversation word for word and commenting on Dieter's impaired comprehension and memory, disorientation, paranoia, anxiety, and auditory hallucinations. Dieter, he wrote, didn't know what year it was, could not perform basic math, and was unable to write her name. Alzheimer found himself repeating every word so Dieter could comprehend his basic questions and instructions. At the time, in 1901, doctors had no term to describe Dieter's condition. Her symptoms were much like the senility known to affect the oldest of the old. At the time, it was thought that the brain wore out over time, much as joints did, leaving the elderly forgetful and confused. If that were true, though, how was it possible for a middle-aged woman to be suffering from old age? Alzheimer was fascinated. Even after leaving his post at Frankfurt Hospital, the German doctor continued to keep tabs on Dieter. In 1906, Dieter died at age 55, and Alzheimer subsequently autopsied her brain. Just by holding it in his hands, he could tell that it had shrunken. Her brain was roughly half the size of a normal one. Then, when he examined slices of her brain tissue under a microscope, he found the cause. Inside the neurons, Alzheimer observed thick fibers that wrapped around the cell's interior, crushing its normal contents. These structures are called neurofibrillary tangles. He also observed clumps of a smooth, plaque-like material that filled the space around the cells and distorted their shape. These structures are called senile plaques. When he published his findings, he referred to Dieter's condition as, quote, "an unusual disease of the cerebral cortex that caused memory loss and disorientation and eventually depression and hallucinations. Within the next 5 years, other physicians began diagnosing patients with the same disease and publishing their findings. A few years later, the disease was named after the physician who first described it, and we now know it as Alzheimer's disease. The most common cause of dementia. The story of Auguste Dieter is unsettling. In her case history, Alzheimer describes a condition that no one wants. Indeed, according to surveys, many of us fear an Alzheimer's diagnosis more than we fear any other disease, including cancer, stroke, or heart disease. It's the kind of disease that we wish had remained rare and obscure. We would like to read about Alzheimer's disease and be able to say, "That won't happen to me." Yet statistics tell us otherwise. Though the early onset form of the disease that Dieter had is relatively rare, the late onset form is not. If we're not diagnosed with Alzheimer's ourselves, we'll know someone who is. While listening about this disease may make us uncomfortable, knowledge is power. The more you understand about Alzheimer's, the better your chances of doing everything possible to prevent it or slow its progression. What is Alzheimer's disease? It's a disease that affects the brain, leading to a decline in cognition. The mental process of acquiring, understanding, and using the information we gather through our senses. Its diagnostic feature is the presence of senile plaques and neurofibrillary tangles. Though new diagnostic tests called beta-amyloid imaging allow us to peer into the brain and see these plaques, the imaging is expensive, not widely available, and is generally only offered to patients who already have persistent symptoms. For the majority of people, the disease is diagnosed based on its symptoms. It's not until after death and during an autopsy that these hallmark features are observed. One of the many brain regions that the disease attacks is called the hippocampus, where newly learned information is first processed. As a result, the memory problems suffered by Alzheimer patients often begins with impaired learning of new information. When these symptoms become severe enough to interfere with everyday life, for example, making it difficult to drive without getting lost, we say you have dementia. Dementia is an umbrella term that describes many different types of cognitive symptoms that can interfere with everyday tasks. Of the many different diseases that lead to dementia, Alzheimer's is the most common, accounting for somewhere between 60 and 80% of all dementia cases. Other types of dementia include vascular dementia. In this type of dementia, hardened, blocked, and leaking blood vessels stop blood from flowing to affected parts of the brain, causing brain cells to die. When physicians use MRI or CT scanners to peer inside the brains of patients with vascular dementia, they often discover that these patients have had multiple small strokes. Often these strokes were silent, meaning the individual is unaware that a small volume of brain tissue has died. Symptoms of this form of dementia vary, depending on which parts of the brain are affected, and they often overlap with symptoms of Alzheimer's disease, confusion, trouble paying attention, difficulty with planning and decision-making, restlessness, agitation, depression, and memory loss. Dementia with Lewy bodies. Named after Frederick H. Lewy, M.D., Lewy bodies are microscopic, abnormal clumps of protein that form throughout the cerebral cortex of the brain, causing nerve cells to degenerate. This form of dementia can be difficult to distinguish from Alzheimer's disease in living individuals. It tends to lead to problems with walking and balance, hallucinations, dizziness, and other nervous system issues, and sleep disturbances. Parkinson's disease. Lewy bodies can also cause Parkinson's disease. In this case, they form deep in the brain, in an area called the substantia nigra, causing tremors and problems with movement. Frontotemporal dementia. Affecting the front and side of the brain, this type of dementia leads to changes in personality and behavior. as the disease erodes the areas of the brain responsible for inhibiting behavior, patients with frontotemporal dementia can become impulsive, and some even show a disinhibited creativity by taking up painting, for example. Inappropriate and compulsive behaviors are common, as is a flagrant lack of empathy for others. Normal pressure hydrocephalus. Derived from the Greek words hydro, water, and cephalus, head, this condition was once referred to as water on the brain. Caused by the buildup of spinal fluid in the brain, it's called normal pressure because spinal fluid pressure remains normal when measured during a spinal tap. This rare form of dementia can bring on intense headaches and dizziness, changes in personality and behavior, trouble walking, and thinking and reasoning problems. An early symptom in these patients that may occur even before memory loss is urinary incontinence. Patients with normal pressure hydrocephalus are unaware of the urge to urinate. This form of dementia can sometimes be corrected with the surgical installation of a shunt that drains the excess fluid from the brain to the abdomen. What causes Alzheimer's disease? Exactly what causes Alzheimer's disease is a mystery that we've yet to solve, but it's thought to involve at least two distinct processes. Plaques. A dangerous protein fragment called beta-amyloid lurks in all our brains. For most of us, the brain clears away these fragments in the same way we wipe the dust off our furniture, and this regular brain dusting operates best while we sleep. But in some of us, these fragments build up over time. While diffusing through the fluid-filled spaces between cells, the fragments start to clump together into plaques, one of the villains of our story. As the beta-amyloid molecules accumulate, they damage and destroy brain cells and impair the communication between them. A type of immune cell called microglia then interpret the formation of plaques as an injury. As these immune cells rush in to repair the plaques, a process known as inflammation, they can further damage your brain cells. Tangles. While the plaques penetrate the spaces between brain cells, another insidious process begins to cause damage inside the brain cells themselves. An otherwise normal protein called tau turns against the brain, and in partnership with other tau proteins, twists itself into a long, tangled thread that gradually strangles the neurons. The misfolded tau proteins cannot perform their usual functions. The normal function of tau is to keep cellular traffic flowing throughout the cell. All the proteins and other building blocks of the cell are busy all the time, getting to work so the cell can function. However, just as a fender bender causes a major traffic jam on a highway, tau tangles can interfere with the transport of nutrients in and out of cells, causing brain cells to degenerate and die. If this damage affected only one brain cell, the effect would be inconsequential. But the true malevolence of tau is its ability to damage tau in neighboring cells, spreading this tendency to misfold, and consequently inducing these long threads widely throughout the cells of the brain. We're not sure which of these processes, the accumulation of beta-amyloid plaque or of tau tangles, is primarily responsible for the disease. Does one of these processes play the starring role as the villain in the Alzheimer's saga, whereas the other serves merely as a sidekick? Are both equally involved? Does one cause the other? Or perhaps we've got the progression backwards, and something else causes both of them. We just don't know for sure. As a result, for many years, heated debates erupted at neurology meetings, with some scientists, known as the Baptists, arguing that beta-amyloid plaques were the more important of the two processes, and others, known as the Taoists, saying that it was the tau proteins that were primarily responsible for causing the disease. Each group believes strongly that they were right. Today, we don't see the issue as quite so black and white. My view is that science is about evidence. It's not about belief. Though we might hypothesize that one protein or the other is primarily responsible, the proof will come from the remedies that cure the disease. With enough study, we will learn the truth. No matter the actual cause, though, the end result is the loss of brain cells. Among the regions most intensely affected are the hippocampi, the seahorse-shaped brain structures involved in memory formation and storage. The amygdala, an almond-shaped brain structure that plays an important role in emotions, and raphe nuclei, a part of the brain stem that is involved in sleep. As more and more brain signals are lost in the hippocampi, it's increasingly difficult to form new memories. Over time, it also becomes harder to pull older memories out of storage. The loss of neurons in the amygdala accounts for many of the emotional issues and personality changes observed in Alzheimer's. As more and more of the raphe nuclei is affected, sleep disturbances result. The symptoms of Alzheimer's disease. Initially, Alzheimer's disease silently snakes its damage through the brain. Plaques and tangles may spread through the hippocampi as much as 10 to 20 years before symptoms set in. It's often not until the brain starts to shrink that memory loss and other symptoms become noticeable. In the initial stages of the disease, many people are tempted to blame their symptoms on getting older. They experience the kind of forgetting that middle-aged and older people like to joke about. Where
am I reading? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.